today's special English episode, the topic will be the very important but not so uplifting or happy topic of climate change.
Yeah.
Woo!
I kind of do this for a living. So I had spent 3 years of my research on researching the connections between energy and climate change. So I'm just searching for an old presentation that might have some relevant information in it for today's discussion. It used to be called global warming, you know. People didn't like it because it was not so accurate. So people started calling it climate change because they discovered that it's not only... The temperature is definitely warming, but it's not only the temperature that is warming, but also there's a lot of other phenomena that are happening. So basically, collectively calling it climate change is more accurate.
Yeah, because the term global warming, you can kind of rebut that by saying that, hey, some areas had more snow than last year. So it's not global warming because this particular spot is colder.
Yeah, true. Then let's kick off the discussion. I have... Number one point, which we always talk about this, is that there's a difference between climate and the weather. Mm. So, you know, just because there is a little bit more snow in 1 year, that's just a particularity of that winter's weather. But the climate is sort of a longer term behavior. I think it is important to distinguish between that. You know, this year it was like super cold in the US Midwest. Mm-hmm. And then Trump tweeted, where is the climate change? But then, and often, even at home in Eastern European countries, you hear that, oh, you know, this year it was so cold or it was so much snow, so where is the climate change? But the way you should be asking the question is like, okay, you know, when I was a kid, the winter used to last from October to April. And now it lasts from December to February. So this is sort of climate.
Okay.
Not weather.
But that's an important distinction, and I didn't know that. I thought that climate is weather, but then, yeah, that's good to know that climate can be thought of as weather in the long term, maybe simplified?
Yeah, something like this. So scientists usually say is that climate is a global phenomenon and weather is a local phenomenon.
Okay.
Oh, and I found it. So basically the WMO, which is the World Meteorological Organization, distinguishes between weather and climate with 10 years. So basically anything longer than 10 pattern, longer than 10 years, it's climate.
Okay.
Shorter than that is weather.
Nice.
The problem is that now we started having processes which start to affect the global weather, which would be the climate effectively, over longer timescales. For example, if you have a dirty city, you have like a factory or something, that's going to affect the air quality in your city. Maybe it's going to even affect your weather. You're going to have acid rain or something like that. But it doesn't affect the Earth's functioning system as a whole. But then if you do this over a long period of time and then you emit a lot of CO2, maybe I'm jumping too much ahead in the discussion here, but yeah, then you start affecting the Earth's climate as well overall.
I see.
So I think with climate change, what has been happening is that the entropy of the weather system has been increasing. So it has become more erratic, or things like having minus 20 degrees on one day and plus 20 degrees on another day are more possible or more likely to happen now than they used to be, let's say, 100 years ago. I found my presentation.
Perfect.
So basically, there was a famous graph published in 1999 by three scientists, Mann, Bradley, and Hughes. And then this, over time, became known as the hockey stick diagram. And basically, the hockey stick diagram showed that the average temperature of the Earth has been quite steady for, let's say, the past 1,000 years. And then since the start of the Industrial Revolution, or let's say 1850 usually is a year that is taken, then it has been massively increasing. Now, this in actual numbers, this means, let's say, a 0.6 degree increase since the world average temperature of 1850. But that the important part is that between, let's say, 1,000-year common era and 1850, there was a pretty flat average temperature on Earth. And then since then, it has been constantly increasing. And now, I think the latest number would be somewhere around 1 degree compared to 1850. So what do you think about this?
First of all, this was just discovered in 1999. Like, that's late. I thought that they knew this sooner. Or they didn't have this solid, clear proof.
I think that's when they actually started calling it climate change.
Okay.
So yeah, it's quite recent.
Quite recent. But, 20 years.
Yeah, 20 years, exactly. But you know, 1 degree, is that a lot or not so much? Well, how do you feel about that?
I mean, the whole issue of climate change seems super scary, but when you hear the number that the temperature raised by 1 degree, you're like, yeah, I'm not scared of 1 degree. I mean, I can wear a t-shirt or I don't know. It doesn't sound scary, but the thing is, it's the average temperature and it has a lot of consequences, I guess.
Earth is actually a very delicate system. So 1 degree for large organisms like the ocean or the algae in the ocean or all the corals in the ocean, for example, it's a massive change, right? They're very, very delicate. Did you know, by the way, that 50% of the corals in the world died between 2016 and 2017? There was like a biggest mass coral extinction event ever because the average temperature of the Australian Ocean, basically the Pacific Ocean where the Great Barrier Reef is, it was a summer, I think, hotter with about 2 degrees than average. And then most of the corals died. So, you know, it's a very delicate system.
But,
it's a very delicate balance.
That's true, because if you just think about yourself, you have the average body temperature, which is 36. And when you have 37, they say you have a fever and you're sick.
Oh, right.
It's just 1 degree. Like your body equilibrium, if it's 1 degree more, you're sick. Something's wrong with your body. So, I mean, this is a layman's metaphor, but the earth is sick. It has a fever.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So basically, yeah, as you said, there's the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, who is, it's not a regulatory body because there's no regulatory body on climate change, but sort of like an advisory body on climate change. And basically, these guys are the committee composed of scientists who sort of make studies and issue reports on what are the dangers of climate change. There is also a UN body called UNFCCC, so basically United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, which is supposed to be kind of like a regulatory body, but just like with the other UN agencies, it's like a nice to have, but I don't think they have any power.
It sounds nice in theory, but it's hard to actually put it in practice. Yeah. With sanctions.
I mean, how can you force China or the US to do something that the UN says? They're just going to say no, and then what are they going to do? So, but then, basically, the IPCC, the leading scientists in the world in this topic for many years, they have issued tiers based on which we should differentiate between the severity of climate change. So, this 1.5 degree is... in order to avoid catastrophic changes to the climate, and I'll tell you in a minute what that means, to have a 66% chance of avoiding catastrophic changes, then we should really limit our warming to 1.5 degrees compared to pre-industrial era, basically. And then just as a context, if we continue on the current trajectory, on consuming on the current rate of economic consumption with using the current fuels that we have, then we are on the trajectory of, let's say, 6 degrees. Some people say 8 degrees, but 4 degrees would mean most of the coastal cities flooded. So a 4 degree change is like a ridiculous amount, like 20 degrees of sea level rise or something like that. So it's an absolute chaos at 4 degrees. And our current trajectory is 6 degrees by 2100.
But then the special report that the IPCC produced on the effects of 1.5 degrees, which we should try to avoid. Is that also catastrophic as well?
So I think the reason that they choose 1.5 degrees is that with the current technology and with the current population centers, humanity will be able to cope with 1.5 degrees if you limit yourself to 1.5 degrees. Because this would still mean severe temperature rises, which would mean a lot of things like crops would shift and fertile desert regions would shift, fertile regions would shift. But the sea level rise, which is perhaps the most dangerous one to human civilization, I think that would be about a meter. Mm-hmm. And then most cities can cope with that level of sea level rise. The thing is, still, for example, the nation of Maldives, actually the government started buying land for relocation in Australia.
Really?
Because the average height of the Maldives is like 50 centimeters above sea level. So there's absolutely no way for them to survive climate change. And there's quite a few other nations like that in the Pacific. So they know that they're gone. So they need to prepare. It's unbelievable, right?
That's crazy. because it seems that climate change is something like a threat which is far away and we need to do something about it. But then for these small island nations is the reality. Like if you're a politician or a policymaker on one of these islands like the Maldives, your actual job is to relocate your country for the people to have somewhere to live.
Exactly.
That's crazy.
And then the big problem about climate change is the first truly intergenerational problem that people faced. So, you know, we've seen sort of global financial crisis before or global epidemics, but those processes were most of the time quite fast. So people in power now would have felt the effects of a financial crisis immediately. So they had a very strong incentive to act. Now, the cost of your inaction will only show in your kids or your grandkids' generation. So, you know, you can be like a little bit of an asshole and just say that, you know what, let's burn it while we can.
Let's see the world burn. Yeah.
Oh, man, we completely missed the discussion that actually, before it was called climate change, it was called the greenhouse effect.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Before even global warming, it was called
The greenhouse effect.
That's true.
Yeah. Because of this history of naming, we have something called the greenhouse gases, which is basically the types of gases that cause the atmosphere to heat up. And then what has been happening in the past 150 years is that we discovered coal, and then we started making steam machines, and then we started making petrol machines, and now we're making natural gas machines. And all of these hydrocarbons, when you burn them, they produce a CO2 molecule which is trapped in the atmosphere. And then it's quite tricky, the CO2, because what it does is it creates a reflective surface that is penetrable only one way. So the sun's rays can come onto Earth, they penetrate the CO2 molecules, the atmosphere filled with CO2 molecules, and then they reflect from the Earth's surface, but the CO2 molecules don't let the sun rays escape into space. So basically it acts as a shield, which only lets the sun rays pass through from space to Earth, but not the other way around. So this slowly this builds up the average temperature.
So it retains the heat more.
Yes, that's why they call it the greenhouse effect. So basically what has been happening is that we have this kind of gases, mostly basically any kind of hydrocarbon-based stuff that we burn in petroleum and in coal and oil or whatever. This has been causing the climate to heat up. But then there is also a lot of... So this would be sort of the primary process. The problem with this 4-degree thing is that why does it become catastrophic after a while is because of a very slight warming. Because of this balance in the Earth climate system, there are a lot of other processes which can become like a chain reaction. Stuff like, you know, if the Earth starts heating 1 degree or 1.5 degrees, then the Arctic ice starts to melt at a rate at which it cannot refreeze itself in the winters anymore. And that's why you have these massive sea level rises. Or stuff like if you lose the glaciers are a huge white surface area. So the albedo of the surface of the Earth changes and it doesn't reflect the light anymore. It just absorbs it. So if you don't have enough snow, then the sun rays are not reflected from the Earth's surface anymore. They just absorb. And this is just a few. There's like a lot of things like this which make it very dangerous. It's like a chain reaction. And so the warming, it's like an exponential curve.
Yeah.
It starts slowly, but then it really havoc breaks loose.
That's scary.
So how do you think? What do you think about our, you know, our outlook?
I don't know. I'm pessimistic. I've been hearing about this problem since I was a teenager, since I was growing up, and all of us were hearing about this global warming, but we always hear about it in a context that it's something scary and we need to do something about it soon, in the future.
Right.
But that's one of the reasons we picked this topic. Recently, like every couple of months, some global report comes out, which is very terrifying and calling for immediate action. It's very hard to be optimistic because, as you said, this is a threat which is in the future and it requires global coordination, and it's a kind of problem which is very hard to deal with, I think, for human society. Probably later we can talk a bit about, because I was reading about game theory and I found like a parallel with this. Maybe we can discuss that in a bit later. But I think this is the kind of a problem which humans are not well equipped to face. Based on evolution, I mean, this is me just thinking out loud, but based on evolution, most of your skills are focused for the immediate short survival. So it's very hard to optimize for
quick gains, quick profit fast.
Profit, quick gains, because if you don't find enough food to survive for tomorrow, then that's it. Like, you're not going to be there to worry for something which is going to happen in 6 years or in 10 years. And also the other thing which you said is like the lack of authority. There's no global
climate
police. Exactly. Nobody to enforce the rules.
I'm glad that you mentioned game theory, because I think this might sound a little bit unorthodox, but climate change might be actually a good thing for a lot of countries in the world. So, for example, the large areas of Canada or Russia now are completely frozen. And apart from the fact that there's a lot of sort of methane stored in the crust of the tundra and the taiga in Canada and Russia, which if that permafrost actually melts, then all of this methane, which is just another type of greenhouse gas, will evaporate in the atmosphere and make climate change even stronger. So apart from that fact, actually, there is a lot of new land area that you can grow crops on before, which was completely useless. So for them, climate change is a net positive, you know? So basically, if you want to bring this into game theory, is that, I don't know, either it's a game of chicken, or it's like a game of prisoner's dilemma.
Yeah.
You can choose either analogy, but nobody wants to act first, because acting first might leave you in not the best position unless everybody cooperatively acts.
What is rational from an individual perspective is
not the best
for the group. And then this is something which can happen.
I think it is happening in climate change.
Currently in climate change, we can say that, let's say everyone is using fossil fuels, putting CO2 in the atmosphere. And then the decision could be that you cut back on your CO2 emission, but that would potentially hinder your economy. Others might gain competitive advantage. So on the short term, for you, it's a irrational, like, losing strategy. Like, you don't want to lose your competitive edge.
Yes.
But on the long term, if the planet is destroyed, then everyone loses. So how can you enforce the group to act on an irrational way individually and to see that on the group level, this will result in better outcomes? And game theory says that one of the ways you can do that, if there's an outside authority. For example, in the case of the prisoners or the bank robbers, there could be that there's a godfather, like a mafia guy, a don. And then the don says that, okay, you do what you do, but if you ratted out your partner, you said that he's guilty and you walk out free,
I'm gonna
kill you. So that's not an option. So when ratting out your partner is not an option, you will act in favor of the group because kind of you're forced.
This is very
interesting. So that's one of the key points, that this authority is missing in the case of climate change.
So I think climate change is something like that. You have to look at time. That, okay, if you keep taking this decision to use the fossil fuels each year, then in the short term, in the 5 years term, your economy is going to boom. But then everything is going to bust and it's going to go to zero. Maybe let's say now your economy is growing with 5% rate each year for the next 10 years. That's massive growth, but then it's going to grow to zero because you cannot cope with the shock that is coming. Whereas the alternative would be to choose, let's say, to replace those fossil fuels with something alternative, which would only allow your economy to grow maybe with 1% per year, but then this 1% could go on for 100 years.
Yeah.
So overall, you end up in a better situation.
But those arguments are pretty hard to make.
Of course, because that's the whole point of the intergenerational problem, that the government is there for another 4 years. So who cares? Climate change is not going to kill you in the next 4 years.
Yeah.
It's going to kill your children. Maybe not even them, only the grandchildren. But actually, just to be a bit more serious, there's also a school of thought which says that innovation will save our asses. I think there's even an article in a famous, I don't know which newspaper, there's a famous newspaper. Which I think
that's a very nice idea to believe in.
So yeah, they say that, you know, you can delay everything because innovation, you know, you will invent a magical anti-climate change weapon because of the natural progression of technology, which could be, I mean, you could defend it if you really wanted to. I wouldn't do it, but I think you could if you really wanted to. I think it was in one of the previous episodes that we discussed that innovation might have slowed down a little bit since early and the mid 20th century. So maybe there is a historical or sort of like a nostalgia bias. That, you know, innovation used to be this fast-paced thing that, we invented the spaceships and telephones, and then most likely it will carry on like that, so we will just invent a fusion reactor or whatever, and it will save us from climate change. But maybe that's not true anymore. So What I wanted to say is that actually the climate change, it's a more complicated prisoner's dilemma because it's a multiplayer prisoner's dilemma, not just two players, but it's a couple of large countries. It's not a 200-player prisoner's dilemma because, yeah, whatever, you know, poor Maldives, they cannot do anything. They don't even actually emit any CO2. Just, you know, the 5 boats that the islands have, it doesn't contribute to the global pool. So the main players here are sort of China, US, EU, India, Russia, the large industrialist countries. You can call them the G7s or the G8s or whatever, that need to get to one table and they need to collectively agree with, as you said, everybody has to agree, because if just one of them defects, then everybody will defect suddenly, right? So if, let's say, all the 7 major economies agree that we're going to reduce emissions from next year, and this comes at a huge economic development burden, and then let's say China doesn't agree, and then suddenly the other countries will be like, oh, you know, you cannot grow at this pace because we need to be competitive with you. So then nobody will agree. So it's like a binary problem. It's all or nothing.
Yeah, but that would be a good solution if all these global powers could agree on a course of action and then also agree that they will enforce it on anyone who's not willing to do it.
True, true. But then there is, let's say, the newly industrialized or the newly developed countries, more specifically China and India, they usually have the argument that, look, US and Europe, you guys used all this coal and all this oil to develop to the level of where you are today. And then historically, you have emitted by far most of the CO2. So now it's our turn. You cannot tell us not to use fossil fuels because you just did it for 200 years. So it's not fair. And then you can kind of understand it, right? So
yeah, it's unfair to pay this price with developing countries who are about to increase their standard of living and get to comfortable lifestyles and deny that from them because, oh, suddenly climate change is a huge problem. Like, you haven't been contributing much, but don't start now. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So especially India, who is expected to have like a very large population growth and also a large economic consumption growth, you cannot tell them not to use coal power plants because it's the cheapest form of power. Of course they're going to use that. Basically, the only people who have to reduce first is the US and Europe. Obviously, you can do some calculations in terms of what's your per capita emissions, and then this vastly changes across the world, and it's sort of more in North America where people tend to live a more energy-intensive lifestyle. But there's another very tricky thing. This was actually what I was working on my PhD, the concept of imported emissions. So, you know, China has a lot of emissions, but that's because the whole world manufactures their stuff in China.
Okay.
So let's say if we make a quota on emissions for each country, then should the quota for China be the quota for China, or should it be the quota for the EU who imports all of their shit from China?
It seems to me that what is a viable course of action, what we can do about it, is more on a global level, more on industry level. And I was wondering if on an individual level, like you and me, people can change this, or that's so low on impact and so uncoordinated that probably it's not worth the effort, or it will not make a large impact.
Are you familiar with the bystander effect?
Yeah.
So do you think that we have a bystander effect in climate change? What you were saying essentially is that, you know, everybody should wait for others to do something before we do something.
Yeah, that's kind of the bystander effect. You're right. But I was just wondering that would it matter, like, if everyone changes their habits when they shop, they don't use extra plastic or extra packaging? Like, would that have a huge impact or not?
Definitely, it would have a massive impact because, you know, there's 7 billion people in the world. So that's a massive number. There's a lot of ways. If you just start buying less plastics, which is all hydrocarbons, right? So it's all made of oil, or it's all made of fossil fuels. Or I wouldn't say this because I'm not a good advocate person, but if you fly less, that's actually the top and largest effect that you can have. So here's another trick. The fastest way of actually reversing the climate change effect, or at least stopping it, is decarbonizing two sectors. One of them is the energy generation, which is currently it's about 40% of all emissions, the energy sector, and another 30% is the transportation sector. So if you decarbonize the energy generation and the transportation sectors, the rest of the emissions is basically the industrial processes, so manufacture of cement and manufacture of plastics. Those are much more difficult to replace. What I mean by much more difficult, it means costs much more money to produce cement in an alternative sort of carbon-free way. For example, perhaps the best effect you can do is make sure that you buy your electricity from a supplier that uses renewable energy or drive an electric car, but also make sure that you charge your electric car with renewable energy from the solar panels on the rooftop and not from a coal power plant.
that's what makes it tricky. I see. There's also another way which I read that could help if you reduce your meat consumption, because I just opened like a graph here. So of the habitable land surface on the earth, 50% is used for agriculture. So that's crazy. That's a huge number.
Half
of the earth is used for agriculture, the habitable half, and then out of that, 77% is livestock.
Oh, man. And most of that livestock, I guess it's cattle.
I don't know the details.
But I think the chickens are usually in a hangar. You know, they're
in
not outside.
In a grand hangar, so they don't use up much space. But
right.
So this is not just about how much percentage uses. It also uses a lot of energy to produce and sustain this industry. So because of this, the reason goes that even if you don't have to give up meat, but reducing your consumption can have beneficial effects.
Yeah, I tend to agree. Or at least there's different kinds of energy intensities for producing different kinds of meat. So I think that sort of beef is the most energy intensive, then followed by, I think, poultry, and then by pork meat, and then by fish. So if you replace, let's say, your proteins from burgers to sushi, that's already a good thing.
If this happens at a massive scale, then...
Yeah, you shouldn't forget there's 7 billion people. It's a massive number. But also, I think one of the more difficult concepts to sell is to consume less. To basically have less shit. That's one of the best ways to reduce climate change. Because, you know, somehow you need to produce that stuff. So that's just energy. So try to reduce that. Don't own stuff, you know.
That needs a change in mentality, a change in current trends.
There's a lot of economists who talk about stagflation and degrowth even. It's quite interesting because, in the past 100 years, and basically the economic leaders of the world now, who are most of the cases economists, they just have been growing up on the ideology that there's infinite growth. We are measuring the performance of a country, not based on their wealth, but based on the growth in their GDP. So basically, and we are even expecting this growth to grow over time. So that's just not sustainable in the long term. But I think the millennials generation, or sort of even younger millennials than us, you know, I think there's room for hope. I think they have a much healthier mentality with regards to consumption. I think they tend to consume less, or they tend to attach less value to things of ownership, I think. Is this your impression?
Yeah, I have the same impression.
I don't know how up to date are you with sort of the Twitter sphere or the Instagram sphere. There's a young Swedish lady, I think she's like 12 or something like that. She's called Greta Thunberg, and what she does is she's very diligent at suing various organizations, including the Swedish government, for climate change.
Yeah.
So this would be effectively one, as you said, one regulatory way. So if actually there is a court which says that they are infringing on your rights to life as a child, then, you know, this is a very twisted way, but I think it might be actually a workable way, the current legal framework, to sue your government that they're not doing enough against climate change.
Yeah, but that can be only done in countries where the judicial system is separate from the government.
Yeah, try to do it in Saudi.
Yes.
You might disappear from one day to another.
But her story is quite spectacular.